I might have to gavel somebody down. I am prepared for everything now. All right, let's go ahead and call this meeting to order of the Santa Barbara City College Board of Trustees for Thursday, November 10th, 2022. And let's see. We are going to start with item 2.2. It's the Pledge of Allegiance, but I'm giving this to Dr. Haslin, to Trustee Haslin, to say a few words and then lead us in the pledge.
Thank you. In the past, the Pledge of Allegiance has been somewhat controversial for us. I remember those days. And I think my view of the whole thing was that we didn't take any time to think about what we're saying, and something repeated over and over again can lose its meaning. That was my primary concern. And that concern is especially true now, because tomorrow is Veterans Day. I am a veteran. I served on active duty for 6 years, and I serve on the county's Veterans Advisory Commission. And my observation has been that veterans are often their own worst advocates in terms of being remembered. And there I have a real problem, because veterans just did their job. They didn't create the war. They didn't write the policy. They just did their job. And that they are not remembered. I mean, Veterans Day is often a day where you go to the beach or do something else that you just didn't have time for anywhere else. So in today's recitation of the Pledge of Allegiance, I'm in hopes that we will take the time to remember those who served, and the idea of military service as part of who we are, and maybe if you meet a veteran, try to avoid "thank you for your service," because you know, but you might have a conversation with that person to express your appreciation. And with that, if you'll stand and you're able, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands,
one nation under God,
with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you so much, Trustee Haslin. Well put. We're on 2.3 roll call, and I want to note that all members of the board are present, except for Trustee Abood, who will not be able to join us tonight, and Trustee Gallardo, who is not with us online at this point. If she does join us, I will speak up so that everybody knows that she's present. I know that that can get lost at times. With that, I'm going to move us along. Welcome. And that brings us to 2.5 longevity. We are honoring four employees this year at this meeting with many years of service. And I want to start with John Leixenring, 15 years, currently a PABX operator and receptionist, Supervisor Palmina Kelly. Brandon Lovelace, 25 years as a network specialist, Supervisor Jim Clark. Then there's Jeff Santa Rosa, 10 years as an athletic program assistant. Supervisor is Ladine Hanston. And finally, Joseph Tammany, 10 years as a laboratory teaching assistant under the supervision of Elizabeth Imhoff at this point. So many thanks for the 60 total years of service that we are honoring tonight, noting that you'll get the real honor in the spring when we do have a special reception for our longtime employees. Thank you so much. Item 2.6, items to be taken out of order. We do not have any items that we are taking out of order, but I will note right now that item 16.2 down in reports, that is being pulled from the agenda for tonight and will come back at the December 15th meeting.
What number was that?
16.2, and I'm just going to read it out by scrolling. It's the annual Equal Employment Opportunity Diversity Report. That will come back to the December meeting.
Okay.
All right. With that, we are going to go ahead and move into closed session. We're going to be talking about item 3.2, public employee discipline dismissal release. We will be back time certain at 5 p.m. So we will see you then. Si, c'est merci, merci.
Oh, cool.
Where did this come from?
I don't
know. I was here. Uh-oh.
Chocolate dessert. Who's responsible for dessert?
I'll bet you Cornelia.
Cornelia?
Oh, thank you.
Are you responsible for dessert?
Danke. Going to go ahead and call us back from our closed session. I do need to get on the Zoom. So give me just a moment to take care of that.
Recording in progress.
Meeting the computer. Audio. Phew. All right. So before we get going, I do want to note that Trustee Gallardo joined us in closed session and she is now present on Zoom. So our only absent member is Trustee Abood. All right, coming out of closed session, I do want to report out that the board took action on item 3.2. Give me just a moment to pull that up. So it was moved by Trustee Everett and seconded by Trustee Haslund to approve the resignation agreement of Vice President of Business Services, Lindsay Moss. Under the terms of the agreement, Ms. Moss will remain in her position until June 30th, 2023, at which time her resignation shall take effect. Following her resignation, she will be paid 4 months' salary in a lump sum. She'll be on paid leave status until the date of her separation. And the vote was 4 in favor. That was Trustee Haslund, Trustee Parker, Trustee Everett, and Trustee Miller. 1 opposed, Trustee Croninger. And 1 abstention, that was Trustee Gallardo. And of course, Trustee Abood was absent. And that is the only action to report out of closed session. We are moving on to general public comment. This is public comment for items that are under the jurisdiction of the Santa Barbara City College Board of Trustees, but not currently on the agenda. Do we have any public comment, Ms. Kelly? No. So we have no general public comment. That brings us to item 6.1, approval of minutes. And under approval of minutes, everything is moving a little bit slow. We have draft minutes for our October 13th meeting. Is there a motion to approve those minutes?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
All right. Moved by Trustee Croninger, seconded by Trustee Miller, and this will be a roll call vote.
Student Trustee Raja Osera?
Yes.
Trustee Gallardo?
Yes.
Trustee Croninger?
Yes.
Trustee Parker?
Aye.
Trustee Haslund?
Aye.
Trustee Everett?
I thought I was on Zoom. I'm listed as being absent, but I thought I attended on Zoom, but I'm not sure. So I'm going to abstain in case I wasn't there, but I thought I was on Zoom.
And Trustee Miller?
Aye.
All right, so that passes with 1 absent and 1 abstention. And moving on down, we are at item 7.1, Superintendent President Screening Committee applicant interviews. We had I think it ultimately ended up being 15 people on Tuesday that presented. There were two people that couldn't make the Tuesday meeting, so we are going to invite them to speak for 4 minutes, up to 4 minutes, describing their interest in serving on the screening committee and how they're particularly qualified to do so. And I want to again say thank you to the incredible candidates. Looking at your statements, it's been just amazing the kind of service and participation that you give to our local community. So thank you. So first up, I'm going to have Celeste Barber for 4 minutes. And then after that, it'll be Joseph Bailey. We're not taking questions. We weren't able to take questions at the last meeting. And so just so you know, don't be surprised that we don't jump in and start asking you anything.
But, I watched it the other
night. Okay, thank you.
I mean, the other night after election.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Or
is that correct? Is that good?
Yep.
Okay. Thank you for accommodating me and allowing me to speak today. I appreciate that very much. And I thought with the 4 minutes allotted me, I would prefer to focus on the qualities that are necessary for the ideal candidate for college president. Each of you already knows me pretty well as being familiar with my connection to City College. There are two qualities that I will screen for throughout the interview process. The first, a person who is a visionary. That a college president's chief role is to oversee an institution whose primary mission is education, so that students who enroll here will graduate the college with a strong foundation, enabling them to enter the next phase of their lives, set to succeed, whether it be transferring to a four-year college or by joining the workforce. Therefore, the next president must possess exceptional leadership skills, be prepared to have a finger on the pulse of the school across the entire campus, and be willing to support innovation and novel approaches to education. And here is one example that I remember from my time here. About 20 years ago, the Luria Library was dying. It was an empty building. And then Kenley Neufeld and Elizabeth Bowman were hired. Pretty much overnight, the library was transformed. And among the many innovations that those two brought, Kenley oversaw the placement of a coffee cart upstairs. Elizabeth arranged displays of books across the library, inviting students to peruse them and check them out. And then another, students were now permitted to talk in the library upstairs. Imagine that, talking in a library, and it transformed that building. In fact, the Luria Library very soon, within a couple of months, became the hub of activity across the campus, and Peter will remember that, I'm sure. I began holding my own office hours there, just inside the library entranceway on a couch. Their hire in the library's dramatic transformation were primarily possible because of an engaged college president, then Peter McDougall. Students who spend time inside their school library will have a successful college experience, both socially and academically. And within 2 years, the Luria Library was honored nationally as the top community college library nationwide. A proactive president understands this and acts upon it. Secondly, the president serves as the face of the college to the community. He or she will function as our ambassador to individual donors and also the community at large, inviting them to understand how the college matters to them, to all of us, and that this campus is a precious resource central to our lives. The Luria Library, the Jerkowitz Theater, La Playa Stadium, the West Campus Overlook, with its Greek amphitheater, where many, many times I took my students, my classes there on lovely summer days. The buildings and beautiful grounds, they didn't just pop up out of the earth. Our campus is beautiful in great measure to the generous support SBCC receives from its community. And the college president is the essential, the vital liaison to that group. As college trustees, your primary duty is to oversee and appoint the hiring of the superintendent president. I would be honored to assist you in this endeavor. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Celeste Barber. And then next up, Joseph Bailey.
Thank you for allowing me to appear. I received a email from City College out of the blue looking for candidates for this committee. I haven't had a lot of relationship with Santa Barbara City College for a number of years. But I thought, oh boy, this might be interesting. So I got on the computer and did some research on Santa Barbara City College. And this kind of tingled me. I thought, boy, oh boy, maybe I can qualify for this thing. I'm 94 years old. I've lived in Santa Barbara since 1944, graduated from Santa Barbara High School. I did attend Santa Barbara City College night for a couple of classes. I've been in Santa Barbara and went to UC on the Hill. But in those days, it was a teacher's college. And after a year and a half, I decided I don't want to be a teacher. So I went to work with my father, J.W. Bailey Construction Company, and we did projects, mostly Ventura, Santa Barbara, and Santa Maria. We also did three of your buildings up here, the parking structure, the tech building, and the building down by the athletic field, plus all kinds of remodeling in this old building. I've been active in Santa Barbara and started with the 2030 Club. I was 50 years in the Suburban Kiwanis Club, including a president 1 year. My wife comes from a teacher family. Her mother was a teacher. Her sister was a teacher. Her aunt was a teacher. My wife was supposed to be a teacher, but the Korean War came along and I got called up and she had to quit and go to work to save our house. I've been involved with the Boy Scouts, Troop 16, for 8 years as an assistant scoutmaster. I was 2 terms of 6 years on the Santa Barbara Rehab Hospital. We're active in the Santa Barbara Scholarship Foundation. Our family has 3 different scholarship thingies, whatever you call them. And I've been involved with Girls Inc. So I've been somewhat involved in education, but not at Santa Barbara City College. I would be honored to be selected to go on this committee. I think the committee is going to be a little weighted on the faculty administrative side, so I think you need the 2 people you're intending to appoint to represent the citizens of Santa Barbara, the taxpayers.
Yes, thank you. And I'm noting that the 4 minutes is up. I also want to note that you win the prize for longest service to the community of Santa Barbara, for sure. Thank you. And I don't know if you were here for Dr. Haslund's comments about Veterans Day tomorrow. He said not to say thank you for your service, but thank you for your service. We appreciate you.
I can hear half of you because my daughter says, Dad, go home and or go back and get some new hearing aids.
There you go. Thank you, Mr. Bailey. Thank you. Okay, that brings us to, I have 2 agendas open, so I've got to be super careful here. All right, that brings us to 8, communications. On the list, first up is 8.2, the report from the Academic Senate. However, I believe Dr. Eckford Prosser is not able to make this meeting, so we will see her in December, hopefully instead. After that, we have 8.3, report from Associated Students, Turner Diallo.
Good evening, everyone. So, the student government has been continuing to do their best to help support student success.
Can I pause you for just a moment? Because I don't think that mic is working right.
It's not.
It does not sound like it's picking you up. You want to, I don't know if you want to move it closer to you to see if that helps.
Hello.
That's much better.
That's better.
Right. Sing into that mic.
All right. Good evening again.
Yeah.
So the Associated Student Government has been continuing to do their best to support student success on campus. And for the past months, I'm going to go over what we have been doing so far and the progress we have made towards our projects. And we have been chattering a lot of students' clubs. A lot of students have been enthusiastic in bringing new ideas to campus, and we help them to bring those ideas to life by chattering their clubs and giving them grants to run their programs. So for the past months, we were able to charter the current events club that hopes to be engaged in current events going around the world, like climate change or political issues all over the world. And we were also able to charter the SBCC Chairs Club, which is also helping out to promote our athletics on campus. And they have been doing a very great job of supporting the football team by attending all of the games and cheering for them. And we were also able to give out grants to 3 clubs in the past month. And the Women for Success Club, which is headed by our student trustee, received a $400 grant for all of their activities in support of all the women on campus. And we also give out a $800 grant to the Women Lacrosse Club, since, as we all know, they are not yet officially recognized as a college athletic team, which is an issue that they need to try to resolve statewide, to have a lot of other colleges to join the petition to recognize lacrosse, women lacrosse, as an official sport. So for now, they are officially a chartered club under the ASG, and we are doing our best to support them until they can be recognized statewide. And we were also able to give out a $400 grant to the anime club that brings out the Asian culture on campus by screening Japanese animes and having a lot of Japanese and Asian culture on campus. And currently, we have an updated list of clubs that amounts to 27 student-led clubs on campus. And next week, Tuesday, we are going to have our club day, where all of the clubs will be tabling on campus so students can come and decide what clubs they want to be part of based on their interest. Or if they don't find any club that has their interest, we could encourage them to start up their own clubs. So everyone in the community is welcome on November 15th to attend the club day on West Campus from 11 to 2 p.m. And this has been organized by our Commissioner of Clubs and Organizations, Emma, who is doing a great job in making sure all of the clubs are taken care of. And just an update on the talent show that was reported last month. We have made a lot of progress by our commissioner of fundraising, Lexa, who has been doing a lot of work behind the scenes. And now we have everything set up and ready for the official kickoff of the fundraising show, which is going to be on December 2nd at the BC Forum on West Campus. And so far we have confirmed Jeff Green, our foundation CEO, as one of the judges, one of the five judges, and Trustee Aboud, who is not here today, is also going to be one of the judges for the talent show, and three other judges. So again, the entire public is welcome to purchase the tickets, which will be going to the funds to be donated to PAF, our homeless service providers in Santa Barbara. And also on Saturday, last Saturday, we had our last football game halftime show for the football team, since they played their last home game against Mopac and they were victorious. And again, the ASG did their part by having the student section on La Playa Stadium. And we had a lot of students turn up with the Vaquero spirit. And luckily our school was victorious in this as well. And they have been recognized as one of the top football teams in community colleges in California. And another update regarding the prayer, meditation, and relaxation space that is being led by our Commission of International Students Affairs, who is very passionate about making SBCC an inclusive space for every international student. And right now she's focusing on creating this space for every religious students on campus to have a space to meditate or to observe their religions. And luckily for us, we were able to work with our advisors and the administration through Dr. Murillo, and we were able to secure room A125, which is in the administration building right down here. So we are going to use that space as a prayer space for all religious groups on campus. And now where we are now is just to decorate the place and bring in everything they need, like Bibles, Quran, and Torah, and every other religious aspect of the room that our students will need in that room. And we'll be looking forward to inviting you all for the official opening of that space. And Trustee Aboud also helped us out in this by organizing a visit to UCSB for us to take a look at their prayer and meditation space to get an inspiration of what we can add to ours or how we can create our own space. And so he took us on a tour at UCSB. And this is their space where we were able to meet not just the space, but other members, or visit the student government of UCSB in hopes of creating a relationship with them for us to work on collaborative projects in the future. That's Trustee Aboud. And also our commissioner, not commissioner, but vice president of external affairs, Divya, has been working towards giving us a campus tour. And the purpose is that we want everyone in the ASG to be familiar with all the spaces or facilities we have on campus in case students are in need of locating a resource or a department. Everyone in the ASG knows where to direct them or who to send them out to. So we'll be touring both the East and West campus on Monday. And then on Wednesday, we're going to go to the non-credit campuses, West and Short campuses, and also have some discussion with their administration, because we plan to create a position in the ASG to have a non-credit student representative to include them into our student advocacy. This is something that was started from our last president, Allegra, who wanted to see that non-credit students are also represented in the Associated Student Government as part of SBCC. So our visit is going to be part of identifying the needs of the non-credit campuses and how interested they would be to have a student representative on the Associated Student Government. And then we also came up with the idea to create a volunteer program for the ASG, since we have a lot to do, but very few of us who also have a lot of other commitments like part-time jobs and full load classes. So we thought of creating this volunteer program to include every student on campus to be involved with the ASG, help us out with projects in committees that ASG members are not available to be part of. And this is also going to be helpful in retaining student government members for the next year when every one of us leave, since those students will have the experience while volunteering with the ASG, and most of them will be first year students. So when we leave, they already have the experience and the basics of what the ASG is and what we do. So it'll make it easier for them to apply and take over the ASG when we all leave. Because in the past, it's been very hard to get applicants to apply for the Associated Student Government. We needed to do a lot of marketing and increase our efforts. But by doing this throughout the year, these people will already be very much involved. So they will be comfortable enough to apply right after everyone leaves. And so far, we have few volunteers who have appointed to several college committees. And we have Daniel, who is in the college IT department committee, and Chantal, Matthias, Chloe, and Lorenzo. These are all students who are not part of the ASG, but they are very much involved in helping us out with all of our projects. And our VP of External Affairs also was able to reach out and work with PAF and the NAACP. And we organized a table for them on campus where they were able to come, have a tabling on campus, introduce themselves to the student community, share flyers about volunteering and internship opportunities, and just get to explore the campus for future collaborations with not just the ASG, but for the entire college in general. And they were also able to reach out to the culinary department, since PAF has this program where they have to serve food like lunch and breakfast and dinner to the people that they are catering for. So they reach out to the to the culinary department, and their students would like to be involved to volunteer in cooking their meals for PAF. And we also have several ASG students, including our student trustee, who will be volunteering on Sundays to go and serve dinner for the PAF members. And that's our report for this month. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Amazing work that's going on with the ASG. Yay. Yeah, it's good to hear. Any brief comments on that, board members?
Just briefly.
Briefly, Trustee Everett?
Yes. Well, first of all, great report. Thank you so much. And I just wanted to make a special comment about the ASG Volunteer Program Committee. I really love that because I often have been in spaces where students have been on committees and for one reason or another can't make it. And so I love this idea of having other students there to so that they're continually engaged, but also as a way to recruit them to more student activities, extracurricular. So I just think it's a great idea along with some of the other things. So congratulations on that and keep up the good work.
Thank you. Thank you. We are now at 8.4, report from classified employees, Liz Auchincloss.
Good afternoon, members of the board.
One moment, Liz, while we get the volume turned up here because it is too soft.
Are you ready?
That's much better. Yep.
Okay, I'll try to talk a little louder too. I want to also commend the students for everything they're doing. It's amazing, all the work they're doing. They're starting to be on college committees and participating, and I think it's great. So I commend them for that. I also wanted to thank Dr. Haslund for his comments on the veterans. I think it's important for us to remember the true meaning of the holiday that we're going to have tomorrow. And I also wanted to congratulate Trustee Croninger for her victory on getting reelected to the Board of Trustees for another term. And the only other item I have is very important to CSEA and to the classified staff. We finally reached a tentative agreement on our contract. It's a year and 4 months expired, but we've reached a tentative agreement that's going through the process of approval. I won't go into detail now because you will be seeing it when it comes to you for your approval, which I hope you will, but some things we had to put off to work on after this because we wanted to get this done, but very important things are happening in it, like the bilingual and the degree extra pay. So it worked out very well. I want to congratulate the district team. Even though it's changed during the process, it worked out. And I want to congratulate the CSEA team and our labor reps. So hopefully you'll be getting that fairly soon for final approval. So we'll have a contract. So that to me is the most important thing that happened in the last week or so. So
yeah, that's pretty big news. So yeah, we'll give that one to Liz Auchincloss. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
That's great to hear. And we look forward to having it come officially to the board. 8.5, this is a report from Faculty Association, Dr. Cornelia Alzheimer-Bartel.
Good afternoon, and wow to the Associated Student Government. This is mind-blowing, what you had to report here. And also wow and congratulations to CSEA for signing the contract. I'm a little bit jealous here, but I also have something to report, and thank you so much for having us again tonight. Can I have the next slide, please? Thank you. Here are the topics for my report today. I would like to begin with a brief but very heartfelt welcome message to our newly and our re-elected board members. Trustee Abood is not here. Trustee Croninger, we are really happy to have you back. And our new trustees, Charlotte Gallup-Moore and Ellen Stoddard, will probably be welcomed next month. Also, I assume that we will have a big farewell party for Kate and Peter, but I want to be proactive today in thanking them for their service to our college. Kate, you truly brought the efficiency of these board meetings to a totally new level. And Peter, who was a Senate president when I joined this institution as a part-time faculty, and who was the board president when we had the longest trustees meeting in the history of this college, the one when we walked out of here at 3 a.m. the next morning. Peter, this college owes you a lot. Thank you. Next slide, please. Last month, we had a faculty association plenary meeting. We decided to do this one again, fully online. We wanted to give as many people as possible the opportunity to attend, and we concluded that at this time, we do not have yet a hybrid system in place that is working well for presentations and allows for good discussions. Our main topics were to share with faculty the highlights of our college budget, provide an update on negotiations, and also get input and feedback on safety at our campus. Definitely, all of us were delighted about the significant number of new full-time faculty we will hire for next year. We confirmed that already in our current adopted budget, the estimated cost of these positions are covered in the salary and benefits line items for this year, in the form of vacant positions, even though the actual hires will only happen next year. We also discussed that there actually is a total of $4.4 million for vacant positions budgeted in this year's unrestricted general fund. The new full-time faculty positions will need only about $1.1 million of this amount. And please let me know if you would like to have my calculations to back this up, either now or in a follow-up email. I would be thrilled to do this. Again, $1.1 million of the $4.4 total for full-time faculty hiring. That means that there are 75% of this amount, or 3.3 million, remaining, which are currently earmarked for non-faculty hires. And after the faculty ranking was a very elaborate and public process, with departments submitting multi-page proposals and data analysis and public presentation, it becomes clear that it is now high noon that we finally put into place the long promised ranking committee for staff and manager hiring. I want to remind us that we just passed the 1 year anniversary that this committee was recommended by the administration and approved by CPC, November 2nd, 2021. We need this committee to start working, and we need to do this now. The FA has already appointed our vice president, Anna Parmalee, to help with this effort. Let's not delay any further. Connected with a budget discussion, we also updated the faculty members about negotiations. Among other things, we talked about the ever-increasing workload for department chairs, about the use of the new state funding for our part-time faculty health insurance, and about, you might have guessed it, COLA negotiations. As you know, we submitted our FA proposal with detailed justification back in September, and we are looking forward to receiving a response from the district team soon. With an inflation rate in the double digits, this is a very time-sensitive and important topic to our employees. Next slide, please. Tonight, I will send you a special version of the well-known statewide Santa Rosa faculty salary study. But here is a sneak preview. You may remember that before last year's COLA adjustment, we ranked in the 60s of the 72 California college districts. This updated document shows you how we would have ranked if that salary adjustment had already been in place on January 1st of this past academic year, which is the date of the last Santa Rosa study. Back then, we would have still been mostly below the median, averaging about 38 of 72. But in the meantime, a lot of other districts have moved forward with negotiations after receiving this year's 6.56% COLA from the state. So again, this was a snapshot almost a year back. Next slide, please. Faculty also talked about how to keep everyone safe on campus during this fall, as well as the upcoming spring semester. COVID is not over. One of my own FA board members has been in and out of the emergency room over several weeks now, first with acute COVID, now with long COVID. A direct reminder for us that this pandemic is not over. Faculty shared with us that they are worried about the messages sent out with our supposedly low infection rates. One of our colleagues asked, for example, how can it be that the college reports only two active COVID infections when in my class alone, I have four students out with COVID? Yes, we know. Not everyone reports positive test results, but that is exactly why we need to be careful to share these low numbers. The bottom line is that it is important that we have solid protective measures in place for our vulnerable colleagues. And the FA would like to thank you that in your discussion about Resolution 10, this was acknowledged. We hope that this intent will be reflected in all our future COVID negotiations. Next slide, please. As in prior meetings, I would like to conclude with a quick look at everything else that the FA has been involved in. Let me start with A, for attending statewide conferences and meetings. You remember that I had to miss your board meeting last month because we sent a group of FA board members to the fall meeting of the California Community College Independents. That is our statewide association of independent bargaining agents in our CC system. This and all other conferences that FA board members travel to are important learning opportunities that help us get better in our work. From this list, I would also like to highlight the evaluation training for faculty evaluatees and evaluators. This is something the FA started about 2 years ago, and we have continued offering this every semester. This fall, we were joined by our distance education coordinator, Josh Ramirez, who, together with Kathy O'Connor, brought to us new insights on best practices in evaluation of online classes and online services. We had over 40 faculty in attendance and also shared a video recording of the presentation. Another aspect that I would like to stress is our outreach to faculty, not only remotely via Zoom or phone calls, but also on campus. The FA has continued to provide coffee office hours in our campus store. We make ourselves available for face-to-face meetings. And when we are on campus, we stop by when we see colleagues in their offices or elsewhere. And if you think that Halloween is kind of an unusual listing on my slides, that one is here to highlight that there was pumpkin decorating offered by the English department, makeup and hairdo offered by our cosmetology faculty and students, Halloween lunch at the School of Extended Learning, as well as the famous PE athletic trunk or treat event. And I'm sure there were many more, and all of them are important to help create a sense of community and belonging on our campus. So thank you to everyone who made these happen. As I mentioned earlier, the FA and others are eagerly waiting for our staff and manager ranking committee to get started, but there are also many other work groups and committees that we regularly attend. So under W, I listed only a few, and next month I will quiz you on what these acronyms mean. And most definitely, it was of specific importance for the FA that the board added a seat for our group on the superintendent president search committee that is about to start next week. Next slide, please. So thank you for your time, and please let me know if you have any questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Alzheimer. I really appreciate that list all the way down to the zillions of emails and personal contacts. That's a lot of work that you all do. I appreciate so much you, and your colleagues that are working on this. All right. And also, thank you for the chocolate.
Oh, yes, thank you.
Yeah, I did receive a piece of chocolate. My only concern was there were two. I was hoping for two.
Yeah,
and I wasn't sure whether the comparison between you and me in terms of sitting in that chair was necessarily complimentary. might it have been that that particular meeting had a lot of things going?
Yes, thank you for your kind words, Cornelia, too. With that, we're on to 8.7, report from Interim Superintendent President Dr. Kindred Murillo. Oh, I'm pausing. I'm trying to jump over the subcommittees. Are there any subcommittee reports? I didn't think so. Okay.
Fiscal committee met.
Okay. Oh.
And we discussed the budget update, the budget work group we are hoping will start in January. And we're planning on a contract with a group that works for FICMAT, because FICMAT was too busy to help us, but this should be a good substitute. And we looked at the 311 and anything else major?
No.
So I think that covers it.
Thank you. All right, now moving on to 8.7. Dr. Murillo.
Thank you. I can build on that just a little bit in the respect that we're still working on the audit, and that should be done shortly. So we will bring that to the December Finance and Audit Committee meeting. And we postponed the facilities and community relations meeting because we're finalizing some work on the physical education building as we speak. And I want to thank Joanne Higdon for a lot of work that she's been doing. And I want to acknowledge all the teamwork from so many people to try to reduce some of the transition costs associated with that building that actually will allow us possibly to build it. So I'm looking forward to being able to present a plan to the Facilities and Community Relations Committee, and then they can decide whether they want to move it forward for the full board's consideration. So I think we're doing everything we can to try to work through this. And I want to acknowledge the athletic department and all of their flexibility, because they're the ones who are going to have to move. So anyway, thank you. I think the next piece is I really want to thank Dr. Haslund and Trustee Board President, Trustee Kate Parker. Thank you for your service on this board. It's been an honor to be here this last year. I appreciate you bringing me in for 2 years. It's been a lot of fun in some ways and not so fun in others, but I think we've done some really good work. And I really do appreciate having worked with you. It's been good. And I want to acknowledge that publicly. And I look forward to our next few 10 months. At least my contract ends in 10 months, and of moving forward with helping you onboard a new president. And I think that your service to the district is very appreciated. And Kate, you should give lessons on how to run board meetings.
Thank you.
So thank you very much. I think I'll leave it at that. And just want to say that as we move into the holidays, that I hope we continue to try to work together on all the things that we're trying to do right now. I feel like we're having some really good conversations. I'm super excited about hiring 18 new faculty. And I look at Denitris when I say that, because I know the work it's going to be for HR. And I think it's really exciting because we're having some really good discussions about how to do this in a way that serves our Hispanic serving institution and the fact that we're a minority serving institution. So we are working with a group on really creating an environment so that we can hopefully continue to diversify our faculty.
All right, thank you so much, Dr. Murillo, and thank you again for the kind words. We move now to the development of the consent agenda. The consent agenda covers everything in sections 10, 11, 12, 13, and 14. Are there any items that board members needed to pull for clarification or a separate vote?
Just a quick comment on, on item 10.4, the decision to award emerita status to Professor Patricia Stark. I just want to acknowledge that Patricia was a fabulous member of this faculty, serving long and hard. And I think this special recognition is especially noteworthy.
You're here. So with that, is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
I have one question.
Oh, you have one question.
Item 15.3 indicates it's a consent item, but I assume that's a inadvertent error, or should it be added to the consent calendar?
It's on for action, and it says consent. It's on for action, and I don't think it matters where we take it. I'm a little hesitant to push it back into consent at this point, since it's under action items. So let's just leave it where it is and note that we're going to be addressing that separately in the action item section.
That's fine.
All right. So is there a motion to approve the consent agenda, including items 10 through 14?
So
Trustee Everett moves. Is there a second?
No second.
And Trustee Haslund is the second. Great. This will be a roll call vote.
Why?
Because Trustee Gallardo was on
Zoom. Okay.
Student Trustee Raja Osara?
Yes.
Trustee Miller?
Yes.
Trustee Hasland?
Aye.
Trustee Gallardo?
She's not in.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Trustee Parker?
Aye.
Trustee Abood? I'm sorry. Trustee Croninger?
Yes.
And Trustee Everett?
All right, so Trustee Gallardo has now left the meeting, so we could have done that as a not a roll call vote. Sorry about that. I did not realize she had left the Zoom. And with that, the motion passes 5-0 with two absences. And we move to the action items, starting with 15.1. This is the 21-22 report of investment income. Dr. Murillo?
We're recommending the board approve your 21-22 report of investment income, and we're here to answer any questions if you have any.
So you can see on the agenda item sort of a summary of where the interest income and the ending balances lie. Any comments or questions from board members? Trustee Croninger?
You know, I'm looking for the button that says raise your hand. Gotten so used to it. My recollection is we had some discussion in the past about doing an RFP for the money, at least at the Union Bank is holding, and to see if we could get higher interest rates. I recognize this is last year, but now higher interest rates are more prominent, and it just seemed like something we might want to put back on the list of things to do.
We'll put it on our list.
Heather?
I'd just add, looking at the numbers, the first category where it says total interest income, $298,000 based on an interest rate of 0.30 to 0.62. I would expect that to triple next year, if not more. I mean, the interest rates have skyrocketed. So that's the good news.
Yeah. And I do recognize that you were going to do an RFP and that didn't happen. So we'll relook at that this spring.
But thank you for bringing it to us, this information, because we haven't seen it all that often, actually.
Oh, really? I thought it was an annual report. Okay. Apologize.
Happy to have that.
Okay.
Is there a motion to approve the 21-22 report of investment income?
So moved.
In a second? All right. Moved by Trustee Miller and seconded by Trustee Everett. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Any abstentions? All right, then that passes with two absences. Next up is 15.2, the 2022 to 2025 student equity plan.
The board has had two reads on the equity plan, and we're now asking you for approval. So.
Great. Were there any comments or questions on changes since we last discussed this? If not, is there a motion to approve the 2022 to 2025 student equity plan? All right, moved by Trustee Croninger.
Second.
And then seconded by Trustee Hasland. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, it passes unanimously with some high fives over there in the seats, and with two absences, the two trustees absent, Abood and Gallardo. Next is 15.3. This is the executive assistant to the president board job description. All right, Dr. Murillo.
Yes, a long time coming. We have reclassified the executive assistant to the president from a management position to a classified confidential position, which is commensurate with the position overall. And with this, we can start a full recruitment. I want to acknowledge Palmina Kelly and all of her work in being the interim and appreciate her stepping in. It's been Palmina and I in the office pretty much since last March. And I just want to give my appreciation and say thank you. And we would like to get this approved so we can recruit.
Yes. All right. People have had a chance to take a look at the job description. Any comments before we bring it to the floor? No?
It's very thorough.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a lot of work and it's unbelievable, Paulmina Kelly, how much you've been doing there with just, you know, you essentially were combining two jobs into one. So really, really appreciate it. All right. With that, is there a motion to approve this job description for the executive assistant?
I'll move approval.
All right. Moved by Trustee Haslin, seconded by Trustee Everett. All those in favor?
Aye.
And hearing no no's or abstentions, that passes unanimously with the two trustees absent. Moving on to section 16, reports and information. 16.1 is student health and wellness annual report. So it's nice to see that back. Dr. Murillo.
Yes, I would like to ask IT to elevate Dr. Whoops, I think I saw him there a minute ago. Maybe he's already coming in. Eric Wilk to provide this report. So there he is. And so he will give the report.
Great.
Ah, there I am. And there you guys are. Okay. Are you able to see me now?
We can see you now.
Okay. I wasn't sure if I was going to be sharing a screen so that I will be doing the slideshow or will IT be doing that for me?
It's up to you. Would you prefer them to do it or would you like to do it? You have the ability to share the screen, apparently.
Okay. So let me try. I'm going to try sharing the screen.
Yeah, a little more audio, if you could.
Okay, are you able to hear me with that?
We can see it beautifully, thank you.
And you're able to see the screen?
Yes.
Okay, so it's great to see everybody and talk to everyone. So I'm very, very happy to be here. I'm Dr. Eric Wilk. I am the new student, the director for student health services, which includes both the clinic and the well, which is kind of what I'm trying to differentiate so that I can have people understand. Oh, sorry, that was probably supposed to be the first slide. So that I can differentiate between the many different types of services I have. I think one of the biggest things with student health and wellness is what we're trying to do and what I used to say my team. I just feel like I'm such a small part in this amazing working group that works so well together. And actually just hearing about the ASG and things that are going on, I'm amazed at all of the different types of activities, the amount of passion that people have for this institution, for all the things that we do, not just for the college, but this is a place that makes a huge difference in our community. And I just wanted to emphasize that. I think one of the hardest and most difficult things, not just in life, but in the school and in everything, is not getting what you want, but trying to figure out what it is that you want. And the biggest thing is awareness. And that's one thing that we come across a lot in medicine. If you've never heard of a diagnosis or a disease or a medical illness or something like that, you will never diagnose it. And the issue is that is coming up more and more and more. The level of acuity of a lot of these things is increasing dramatically. And we have an amazing group that is handling this with just amazing grace, flexibility, adaptability to all the different situations that we have, beginning with COVID, during COVID, and while we're in this odd kind of endemic, as people are calling it, COVID stage. So let me see if I can switch here. So the things that I'm going to talk about are college student health study, which just kind of gives an idea of what our students are kind of carrying every day besides, you know, huge, massive, heavy backpacks. There's a lot more on their shoulders than what you see by just seeing the outside of them. And that shows a lot. And what's interesting is that actually the HSA-CCC, which is another place that does a lot of research, just 2 days ago came out with their newest study, and it's almost even more daunting. So again, as I said, we have student health services. There's two parts I'm trying to differentiate between the clinic and the well, because the clinic has medical services and mental health services. A lot of people will say counseling. Counseling comes up a lot, but people often do not understand that we actually have mental health counseling. And we're really trying to say mental health and put an emphasis and focus on that, because before that wasn't necessarily the best term to use, but now it's really important for people to call it for what it is, which is mental health. And it's important to have that. And it's important many times to go in before you have a crisis situation. It's almost like having a mental massage. Most people can benefit from it. And then the third component, the third kind of arm of our team, which is a huge stabilizing force, is the well. And this is a really incredible new addition that many community colleges all over California are fascinated by, interested in. How did they do it? What are they doing? How are they bringing people in? What are the things that's making it a success? How does Becky Bean do all this with such a huge smile on her face all the time? It's amazing. And that's true for our counselors, our medical professionals. It's really amazing. People here love what they do. And I think if we have any conflicts, a lot of times they're heated. To me, that shows the unbelievable amount of passion people have for our students and our community. And then that brings us to the community partnerships. So these are the big, are you still able to see this? I want to make sure I'm doing this right. Are you able to see the screen?
Yes.
Okay, so these are some of the biggest challenges that we're having now. And a lot of this is, basically has blossomed during COVID, during that kind of isolation, not being socialized, not knowing what other students are doing, what you should be doing, are you doing the right thing? And emotionally not having that socialization. And people are self-medicating. So we're seeing a lot of addiction, tons of anxiety, depression, eating disorders. There's obviously grief and loss that people already have talked about with the board. And unfortunately, we're seeing suicide. And as a anesthesiologist, I'm far too familiar with that, because it's the anesthesiologists have the highest rate of suicide, and actually we're very successful at it, which is unfortunate. And I'll talk on that just a little bit, because I want to discuss the behavioral interventional team that we have, that a lot of the people in the student health services are also involved with. So here at Student Health Services, they have it so that anybody that is a student pays a $23 fee that's set by the Chancellor's Office. And with that, as I said, there's just a huge range of services that we offer. And if we do not offer those services, we don't want to say no to anybody. We want to say, if we don't know, we will look for you and we will find out a place for you in the community and how you can get the services that you need if we're not able to offer that. And that's medical, mental health, our counseling appointments. And actually, I've just been talking with Dr. Susan Lawton, and we'll be starting in the spring having neighborhood clinics come back so that they can do a lot of our sexual health services. They used to come twice a week. I was here actually 10 years ago working in student health services, and a lot has changed, but many of the connections that we have throughout the community are still very, very strong. but there are so many more. And I don't know all the letters and acronyms. I think it's a brand new language and I'm pretty good with languages, but I still haven't caught up. So these are the different things that we're doing with the student health services. Health and Wellness is having a lot of workshops, counseling. There's a lot of integration now, which I've been trying to coordinate because we are a team and the well is not just a service, but it's a space. It's a very safe space. I forgot who was it, ASU president was talking about the space that they have in the academic building. It's similar to that. And that often is kind of a springboard for a lot of the other programs that we have to help our students. This is what the HA has found out, and we're seeing the same type of numbers in the newest survey that I talked about that came out. It's incredible that these are the answers of students and what they're saying. Over half of the students are saying that they have had major academic issues because of their mental health. 30%, that's almost a third of students have said that they are suicidal. And I'm not talking about, have you thought of suicide? Has that crossed your mind? This is where they actually are suicidal. They have thought about it. They have come up with a plan that is doable. They have access to what they need to do as a plan. This is basically a major emergent situation. And we've actually had, unfortunately, a number of near suicidal places where we've had to have people go out, call 911, do welfare checks, all sorts of things. 3/4 of the students have said that they've had over the past year psychological distress, and over half of them feel lonely. These are just staggering numbers, especially for a population that is usually absolutely flourishing. Everything's going great, and they're definitely not focusing on the types of things that they're focusing on now, which is turning their eyes kind of inwards and in their head and having difficulty getting out and interacting with other people and the world. So the medical services that we have a nurse and a nurse practitioner. We all sorts of types of, I can't even tell you how many different types of diagnosis we've had. We've had everything from skin issues, diagnosed Guillain-Barré, which can be life-threatening. It's a very odd, demyelinating disease that can happen within 24 hours or less. That's sort of like a massive onset of multiple sclerosis where within hours you can stop breathing. It seems like, it looks like the flu, but if you miss a few certain characteristics of things, you'll miss it. And we are catching these types of things. We're seeing everything from scabies to mono, influenza. We're diagnosing COVID. A lot of the numbers that you will see actually do not show the amount of work that's being done because so much of it is done is during screening. So let's see, we'll go on to the next. So this is a number that there, it looks like it's missing a zero at the end. And because those are the numbers that probably, I think were closer to the last couple of years. This is the number of appointments we had, but I can tell you that Brenda and Mary have been on the phone talking with students outside of student services so that they don't come in the building and infect other people with possible COVID, helping so many more people. This number probably is, as I said, an order of magnitude off. Our mental health counseling has really blossomed in a lot of ways. And I think the biggest thing, again, is to get people to understand that we do have counseling. It's not just academic, but we do have a lot of mental health counseling. They are seeing just an incredible number of people, both in group sessions. They're doing one-on-one sessions during a lot of COVID. During COVID, they actually had so many people that started becoming, because they were really quick to adapt to having students be able to do their counselings via remotely. And it seemed as though the numbers were dropping, but right now it seems to be that that is actually a completely different cohort of students that most likely would not have even accessed mental health counseling or the different types of groups that are available, simply because they might not have wanted to walk in, and it makes it much more accessible. So we're having many students that want to have one-on-ones now where they can see people in person, but there also are still a lot of people that want to have it done virtually. There's maybe there's a lot of difference where they might want to have that. We've had, since mental health counseling has been kind of a buzzword lately, we've been able to, I think Lacey and Allison 2 years ago were able to get a grant to get another BIPOC counselor to work with the EOPS students. Right when I came on in February, ran to the board of trustees that's you guys. Where did I go? Santa Barbara Foundation, And we discussed the issues with mental health and the counselors. The counselors have to have over 3,000 hours before they can be licensed. And Santa Barbara City College, even when I was here 10 years ago, was probably the largest, best place that most people wanted to come to, even though they were working without being paid. It's getting more difficult now because a lot more places are wanting these counselors that many times even have PhDs, but still are not, quote, licensed. So we've been able to actually secure funding for them so that we will be able to give them stipends for the hours that they're working. The Anchor program is a really strong part that Lacey Peters has been working on. A lot of that has to do with in-person, and it's where we have a lot of substance use and prevention. I actually accompanied her a few times for training with Narcan and getting the information out that it is not, try to destigmatize it and have it, it should be like an AED and a fire extinguisher. Naloxone should not be looked at as something that is a stigma where, oh, you must be using. This is just something that can save someone's life from a disease. And I carry it all over the place, wherever I go. I also carry an EpiPen. And it seems as though that message is starting to come across. We went over to Sharon Callis had it, so we could talk to people in the nursing program, in the nursing lab, and we're trying to grow that more and more for just getting the word out and having the students get the word out to their peers. So when someone talked about having kind of one person that represents a certain community, that is one of the best ways to actually get information across. I did that with a program in Guatemala for about 6 months, where we had different groups all around everywhere from Tikal and Rio Dulce, other places. It actually works. Let's see. This is the number of counseling appointments they had. We wish our rooms could be a little more like this, but they still are very, very cozy. In the Well, we've had over 500 participants. Many times the participants are actually people from other colleges looking in going, how did you do this? What are the things that you're doing? Many of the things that we're doing with groups, they're also being videoed, taped, so that anybody can go online and access a lot of the information that we have. They can access videos about different types of topics. They can access videos on nutrition, counseling, meditation. Betsy does amazing work with yoga, and I think they're having soon, what is it, a words, there's another program that they're coming up with soon, but there's lots of activities. I think one of the biggest things would be trying to come up with a calendar, which we have for the well, but trying to coordinate that calendar with others so that most people can see what is going on, what is available to them. That's one of the most important thing. They had, I think, 23 unique health and wellness workshops in counseling. They had skill building groups with over 500 students. And let's see, next slide. The hygiene kits, this is from AB, what was the number? 367, which is the menstrual products for all, which is new legislation that has come in, I think signed by Gavin Newsom. And we're already way ahead. We're supposed to have at least one location where we have menstrual kits available for free. And then in the bathrooms, we're supposed to have information about that. We're working, I've been talking with Paloma to try to get, and Chris, getting the information out there in the bathrooms and also having dispensers. We have hygiene products in the well, student services, we have them at the clinic, and we're working on getting them in the library because that's a place that is open later. I think we even talked about getting them in Umoja and other places so that these are readily available. And we're calling them menstrual products, not feminine hygiene, because there's a, and we also want them to be in non-gender bathrooms and at least one male bathroom, because these also are very sensitive issues and address people that are often going through determining what is their gender identity. And so calling it feminine hygiene products, I think it's just much easier. And a lot of people are saying it's just much easier and actually kind of more focused on what they really are, which is menstrual care kits. Just as an aside, menstrual care kits or just menstrual products are taxed. They're taxed at a luxury level. It's like a luxury item. I feel that it's very important that we have this out, and it should be looked at as if it were toilet paper. It should be available free for everybody. The amount of partners that the well has is, I asked Becky if she would, Becky Bean, if she would start writing a list or make a list of, show me a lot of the different collaborations and partnerships. I've asked Lacey Peters also of the connections she has with UCSB throughout the community. She's been around Santa Barbara for a long time. I asked Allison Boswick, and she's been here for, I don't even want to say how many years because I think it's older than she is. It's just amazing how many people are really vested here at Santa Barbara City College. And the number is just really unbelievable. And these collaborations are getting stronger and stronger and stronger, so that we're not working in isolation. 10 years ago, I started working with UCSB with the head of their student health department. And fortunately, her husband was the head of Santa Barbara Public Health Department. And that was wonderful because then during that time I helped set up with the nursing program. It happened to be H1N1. Now it comes during COVID. I'm not sure why that is. I don't think it's me. But we did the huge vaccination program there for H1N1. I think it was the largest. We got more of the vaccines even before the Department of Public Health was able to get a large one going. I could talk more about these. This is the anger program that I was talking about with the Narcan and going to a lot of the different classes. We want to get this information out. I was just reminded there's a new law that Gavin Newsom actually just passed, and it's, I think, 2122. I'm not quite sure. But a lot of this is also about mental health. And we now have in Santa Barbara 988, which is the mental health hotline. 911 is, as you know, for medical, and now they have a specific one for mental health. And it's become law so that any new student ID cards that come out starting January of 2023 must have mental health hotline written on that. And I've looked it up, and 988 is absolutely perfectly acceptable. This is, I think this slide actually pans down for about 10 minutes in terms of the community partners. And if we talked about each one of these, I'm sure that my team members would be able to name people, individuals in all of these that they know and have worked with for quite some time. Ah, there we go. And that is all. Does anyone have any questions?
Wow, thank you so much, Dr. Wilk. It's amazing the work that's going on in the Student Health Center, in the Well. It's hard to hear how many students need the type of support that's being provided, but I'm so grateful. I know that we all are on the board are so grateful for the work that you and your team are doing for these kids. And I say kids, they're students of all ages, of course. So with that, I'll see, does anybody have any questions, Trustee Croninger?
I just wanted to echo what you said, Kate, because I had the opportunity to meet Dr. Wilson, chat with him at the reception we had for new faculty and administrators. And I was just so impressed with him and with the program and his enthusiasm for the college, for working with people, for, I don't know, I think the word that first comes to mind in talking to him was his empathy for everyone. And he's the kind of person I can see our students wanting to talk with and bring their concerns to, as well as the whole team. So I think it's just a wonderful program, and I'm so grateful we have Dr. Wiltz leading it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Trustee Everett?
Yeah. I have a question, a comment more so than a question. I just want to echo what you two just said. But I wanted to say that I was surprised but delighted to hear you mention the menstruation products. I've been working on destigmatizing menstruation programs. And so I was really happy to see and hear what you had to say about that, particularly the fact that that menstrual products should be available like toilet paper. And in some countries, they're starting to do that. So thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's something that I've so appreciated in California in particular. I think California is a bit of ahead of the curve on this. And if only things had been the way they are now back in the day, that would have been right.
Yeah, right? Right. So
all right. Thank you so much, Dr. Wilk. And until next time. We move on now to 16.3, because as I mentioned before, we're pulling 16.2. So 16.2 is the apportionment recal period CCFS-320 report.
Dr. Reese will walk us through real quickly the report, just to kind of clarify a couple of questions that were asked earlier.
Good afternoon, trustees. Thank you for having me here. So real quick, going through this one, I was noticed that when we kind of wrote through the description of this item, I only mentioned one comparison, and there's actually two comparisons in there, which could have gotten a little confusing. So if we are looking through here, let's see, do I have laser? I do have laser. All right, so this is the main comparison that we look at here. This is comparing the recal from 21-22 to last year's recal. So that's what we typically focus on at this point. However, we also included over here a one that is, and this is within this year, the change from our annual period to this period. And this is kind of interesting to note because in this recalibration, and this is what we do after the annual, we see, okay, things have come in. We look through our numbers again and see if there's anything we missed. And in this particular time, we did find some errors in the way that the system we used to compile this was computing some of those. And we found an additional 83 FTS, which is very useful and meaningful for us. So just want to do some clarification on how to interpret this report when you're looking through these. So, and if we kind of we'll have up on the top here. I think this might be the first time that y'all are seeing this in this format as well. Okay, so I'll spend a little bit more time on it then. So these are going to be your two main columns that we're looking through. When we do our apportionment report, it's divided up by our various terms. So we've got our summer terms and our spring and fall term. You see these up here. The 320 is kind of a summer sandwich. So you've got kind of your summers as the bread and the semesters as the biddle bit. I don't know. We have a lot of different calendars. Good luck keeping track of them all. This particular one has our summer two as the first part of apportionment and our summer one in the next year as the last part of the apportionment with fall and spring in between. So you'll see over here kind of where we're at with that. We have a kind of decrease in our the FTS we're claiming in there. See that at minus 18 for summer two and about minus 3.1 with a minus 12.2 overall for our summer totals. Down here, you'll see our primary terms. So our fall and spring, interpreting them the same way. Here's kind of what we have for this recal period. Here's what we had for last year, the difference in numbers, the percentage. And then this over here is the difference from the annual period of this year to the recal period. And then if we scroll down to the bottom, please. Thank you so much. So now we get into our non-credit FTS. These are more complicated. We have two primary flavors of FTS in non-credit. We've got enhanced and unenhanced. Enhanced get paid at a higher rate, main thing to keep in mind in there. So as you go through here, that's why the non-credit section is much more lengthy because it kind of clarifies each of those and then gives you your subtotal as well as your change. And then at the very bottom, we have the interesting numbers. So let's go ahead and see if we can get that last row, the totals. And here we've got down here. So this is the difference from our annual apportionment period to recal. So that's 83.58. That is atypical for us. Usually we have about, you know, 7 to 20, but this year we did find, we're starting to use some new apportionment methods and that the software we use hadn't quite incorporated those yet. So found that out, fixed that up. And that's why we have that larger change here. Overall, we're down 2% from last year's FTS. And that is the recal report. Any questions?
Any questions, board members?
Oh, thank you.
Thank you very much. And next is 16.4, the monthly budget update as of October 31st, 2022. And this is just our regular summary. Does anybody have any questions on this budget report? Seeing none and checking online. All right. Thank you for the regular update. And we have no questions at this time. This moves us to item, to section 17. First off is 17.1. This is our standing item on the superintendent president search update. If you look at the item, then you have, you can see that there's some bullet points on what's going out. Some important ones to note are that we have a survey out that I have now sent multiple. I feel like, I don't know, I feel like some sort of marketing guru at this point, but I've been sending out multiple emails asking members of the campus community to fill it out. It takes, it depends on how thoughtful you are. It can take about 60 seconds if you are not particularly thoughtful and already know. But a little bit more time if you want to mull things over. And as of now, so first of all, that survey closes tonight at midnight. As of now, 5 board members have completed it. So and it's anonymous. So I can tell you what category, but I can't tell who. So two of you still, please go ahead and fill that out tonight by before midnight. And the other thing that's not on here that I want to make clear is just that we do have two special meetings coming up to do with the president search. One on Thursday, November 29th, Tuesday, November 29th, and one on Thursday, December 1st. Okay. Any comments or questions just on this sort of broad area here on the search update?
Kate, yeah. With respect to the survey that you mentioned, it occurs to me that electronically things happen. I know I filled out the survey. What I don't know is, did they receive it?
If you hit submit, they have received it.
Okay.
A person who believes in technology.
Yeah. Do you have any indication of how the community response is?
I don't yet. So we will hear more about that from our search gurus the next time we see them. All right. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and move us to item 17.2. This is appointment of community members to the Superintendent President Screening Committee. I do want to note that Trustee Gallardo has rejoined the Zoom, so she is back and able to participate in our vote on this one. So we will take a roll call vote. Last time we went through this process, Trustee Miller was president of the board, and what he did was essentially have us share out our two top candidates. I know it's hard to decide because there were so many great candidates with amazing backgrounds. What I will do is have Dr. Mio, will you take notes on that? So if she'll then just tell me who the two highest numbers are, if there are anybody that repeats, because honestly, with the number of people, there may be no repeats, in which case we will have to narrow things down. But if there are anywhere more than one trustee has indicated an interest, then we will include them and create a motion to create a final vote and see about taking a vote on appointing them to the screening committee. Does that make sense? Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So with that, if it's okay, I'm going to start with Trustee Gallardo since you're on the Zoom and I don't want to forget you at the end, Veronica. So Trustee Gallardo, you want to share your top two?
Yes. And as we speak, I'm trying to watch the video because I don't have my notes, but I can describe and I can hear you saying the pledge. One of the community members, and she was at the beginning, she mentioned her grandchildren. Do you recall her name? Can you hear me, Kate?
Yes, I can hear you. Okay. We're all sitting here going, okay. Grandchildren.
I just pulled up the video from the meeting. And so basically I'll preface with this. All of the candidates had stellar resumes and backgrounds, many of which I would anticipate one day seeing on our experts and volunteers, agenda as people that would serve this college in some capacity. What I was looking for, my ear was listening for was someone that was specifically a standalone community member perspective. With that lens of someone that would come in to join this cross-functional team of folks that are already playing different roles at the college and as part of the committee. And there was only like three people that were specifically just community members that would provide that lens. And it was her. And then actually just the gentleman that spoke earlier that came to the podium. And so that's what I'm leaning for. I'm leaning for just strictly two community members that will provide that lens and nothing else. And like I said, all the resumes were stellar, but for this position, I want the viewpoint of just a community member. And there was about three. Did you find her?
Were you talking about Julia Schechter, the one, and I'm trying to remember, I feel like she had been a college professor back East.
Of America. And then she moved to Santa Barbara to follow her grandchildren.
That's the part where I don't remember the moving to the grant for the grandchildren part, but it absolutely could be true. But I just want to note that we can always reopen. So on the agenda for our last meeting has their bios. We can see if she mentioned grandchildren in that.
I'm looking right now and I'm not seeing.
Trustee Parker.
Yeah.
I was thinking it was, she was describing Mill Duncan.
Oh, maybe Mill Duncan. Oh, yes.
She was, I think the fourth person, third or fourth person.
Yes, that is ringing more bells. You're right. I bet it was Mill Duncan. But let me pull
it's
that
not
up.
Schechter, because I'm looking at her.
You're saying different things on their statements in person than what they are mm-hmm. obviously were sharing on their resumes. And we all were paying attention to slightly different aspects of their statements. So hold on a second. I'm just pulling that up. So it sounds like you would like to have Joe Bailey as one of your the people that you would put forward, Veronica. And I just want to... Just gonna
Mill Duncan mentioned in her write-up that she moved back to Santa Barbara in 2019 to be near her grandchildren.
There you go.
Yes, that is correct. And I just found her at 37.23 minutes. Yes, good memory, Palmina. So yeah, that would be my consideration. Just two community members that will provide that lens and complement the faculty and everybody else.
Great. And I should note that Lee Heller pulled herself from the candidates or the applicants because she can't make one of the meeting times. And I should double check everybody else can still be on the list. And I want to be sure that includes Matt Niemer. I'm not sure that everybody from the original list made the agenda item for tonight, but I just want to be clear that everybody else is still in the pool. All right, so that's it for Trustee Gallardo. And Trustee Hasland, who would you like to share your top two?
I was saddened to see Lee Heller withdraw because she was on my shortlist. Mm-hmm. But I think I will go with Leslie Westbrook and Celeste Barber.
And Trustee Everett?
I tended to agree with Trustee Gallardo, and I was torn because I was thinking to have an outside perspective, an outsider perspective, although I really liked Peter Rojas for someone, but I thought we need somebody from the community that isn't so tightly involved with the college itself, so we can get that outsider point of view. Mm-hmm. So I tended to agree with that. With that being said, The one person who mentioned grandsons was Robert Ingenhoff. He was wondering if the fact that his grandsons were here, does that create a conflict of interest? And I was wondering about that too.
It does not.
Okay, all right. So my choices are Leslie Westbrook and Todd Aldridge.
Okay. And Trustee Miller?
I was also looking for candidates who were very active in the community, and I must say that there were a lot of them.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I kind of felt inadequate reading the statements during their presentations, wondering how I had wasted my time today. But having said that, I thought that John Burke and Todd Aldridge fit the description of people. Individuals who were very active in the community, and I think are had a lot of things to recommend them.
And Trustee Croninger?
Well, first off, like everyone has said, this is just a fabulous pool of people that we have before us, and I think all of them are well qualified. So that makes it difficult. It even made me think momentarily of, should we have a community committee separate from the other committee, and then they can come together at the end and make their recommendation, but I'm sure our consultants would go crazy and that would be complicated. So I too was looking particularly for a community viewpoint. We have wonderful representatives already in this group that know the college really well and know the issues that we're facing in the students. And I think that a tremendously important part of this job is the relationship of the president to the community and the ability to relate to people in our community and be basically the face of the college in the community. And that's one of the reasons Peter McDougall was so successful. I mean, he was just amazing at that, and not to mention starting the foundation and running the college. But it's, you know, it's different skills. And so I'm looking for community members that recognize that and can advocate for that. And I thought that, so my top choices in that regard were Robert Engelhoff. I think he really put that in front of us and said, this is important. And Todd Aldrich as well. I feel like both of them are people who really understand what the community piece of this is. Not that we don't have a lot of different communities, we do, but I think they would speak for that skill.
And student trustee Raja Osero, do you have two that you'd like to share?
Yes, so Leslie Westbrook, because she emphasized important areas for students, she was very specific. She talked about accessibility and mental health, and she mentioned something really important that kind of made me think a lot yesterday. She said that we need to hold on to our students, our current students, and be inclusive to them. And also Joseph Bailey, because of his involvement in the community throughout the years and willingness of being involved in SBCC now.
Thank you. And I could echo what everybody else has said, but I won't to save time. And my top two were Matt Niemer and Leslie Westbrook. And so with that, are there two that have gotten more shout outs?
Would you repeat what Adriana said?
She said Joe Bailey and Leslie Westbrook. Yep.
Joe Bailey. Okay.
Okay. So looks like Leslie Westbrook was your number one. She had 1, 2, 3, 4 mentions. And then you had Todd Aldrich with 1, 2, 3. And that looks like those are your highest.
Two highest ones. All right. With that, is there a motion to approve Leslie Westbrook and Todd Aldrich as our community at large members for this screening committee?
So moved.
And a second?
I'll second.
Great. And this will be a roll call vote.
Student trustee
Rajan
Sarah?
Yes.
Trustee Gallardo?
Yes.
Trustee Miller?
Yes.
Trustee Parker?
Aye.
Trustee Croninger?
Yes.
Trustee Everett?
Aye.
Trustee Esmond?
Aye.
All right. That is all set then. Now, I've got to jump back to the other agenda. Sorry, back and forth between November 8th and November 10th. Mm-hmm. Let me get November 10th back open again. That brings us to, our turn. Appoint Board of Trustees members to the Superintendent President Screening Committee.
Your constituencies are the next.
Oh, sorry, the ratification and appointment. I'm jumping 17.3. All right, 17.3 is the ratification and appointment
of college constituent members to the superintendent president screening committee. These are the ones that came forward out of the various constituency groups. And is there a motion to ratify and appoint these members to the superintendent president screening committee?
So moved.
Second. All right, moved by Trustee Miller and seconded by Trustee Everett. And we will take a roll call vote on 17.3. Oh, did you want to make a comment?
I'm wondering about the two vacancies. How do we want to, do we just bring that back?
I think ultimately what has happened is people have really tried. Corolla did try really hard to get somebody from the School of Non-Credit. And the same with the faculty. So but you're going to start meeting next week. So
yeah,
actually there is one of those vacancies has been filled.
Oh, it has?
From yesterday, yes.
Oh, good.
Do you have a name that we can add to that then?
Yes.
What's the name?
Not the one, the student from non-credit has not been filled and it doesn't look like it will be filled.
Okay. So what about the name of the non-credit faculty member?
I was confident. I'll check on it.
I'm sorry that I didn't know we were having trouble recruiting for the students, because I know quite a number of students and could at least have tried to get somebody to sign up.
The first meeting is what date? Next week?
Yeah. Yeah. Next Tuesday, if you have somebody. That.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I'd just start calling.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What was the name?
A-F-A-F. Turjoman.
T-U-R-J-O-M-A-N. We're struggling against the motor revving outside. What in the heck? Trish, did you say Trish Afaf?
A-F-A-F.
A-F-A-F, okay. So that is the non-credit faculty member appointed by the Faculty Association non-credit. I'm not sure. This is a ratification. Mm-hmm. So it is possible to ratify after the fact. And I would be very comfortable if a student comes forward in the next few days to go ahead and have them start to serve. And then at our next meeting, we'll put this on as an item to, again, ratify, since we can ratify after the fact. Trustee Everett?
I was wondering if AS President Diallo can find someone, because remember he was talking about getting the non-credit students from SHOT and so he may be able to have somebody that he can recommend.
It could be, but I know that that is kind of the weakest link with the ASG is the non-credit students, right. And so maybe Marsha, if you know people, if you want to liaise with student trustee Raja Osera and ASU President Diallo and see if between all of you, you can come find somebody that's interested and has the time, because the issue is that they must go to all of the meetings.
Right.
Okay. All right. And if you're able to, please let us know and we will ratify it at our next meeting. And I'm just getting clarification on the name. So it's Afaf Turjoman. Thank you. I appreciate the clarification. That's much better than what I was attempting to hear over the motorcycle or car or whatever it was. Okay, so we do have a motion on the floor to ratify this list. And we will take a roll call vote.
Student trustee Raja Osera?
Yes.
Trustee Miller?
Yes.
Trustee Haslund?
Aye.
Trustee Gallardo?
Yes.
Trustee Parker?
Aye.
Trustee Croninger?
Yes.
Trustee Everett?
Aye.
All right, that passes unanimously with Trustee Abood absent.
Can I make a correction? I said next Tuesday. It's actually next Wednesday afternoon.
Next Wednesday afternoon.
For the first apologize.
This brings us to 17.4, appoint the Board of Trustees members to the Superintendent President Screening Committee. The last I heard, there were three of you interested. I know that Trustee Abood is interested, not here. Trustee Everett, you're interested. Trustee Miller, you interested?
Yes.
Okay, we can only put, well, I don't want to fuss too much around this, and I want to be clear that when the members of the board serving on the screening committee, it is much more of a listening role, and we have to be careful to really get the community, the campus community and the community at large to hear those voices. I know that there's always the worry that the board will dominate a screening committee when the board is going to be doing a ton of work as a group itself once the screening committee comes through. So if possible, I would like to keep it to two board members on that screening committee. And Trustee Gallardo, jump in. What would you like to share?
Yeah, I want to be able to do this. I need to throw my name in here to be able to do this. We're a Hispanic serving institution. We have a large district, and it'll help us to continue to diversify our board voice.
So, Trustee Gallardo, you're interested in serving as well?
Yes.
All right. So, four of you are interested in serving, two spots. Any thoughts on how to move forward with that, Trustee Croninger?
Well, I didn't know that Trustee Gallardo wanted to do it as well, but what I was contemplating was that there are different jobs here. There is a job for being on the screening committee, and I agree with you that the board should not dominate it, and I don't think any of our board members would. But they do go through the process, the full process of evaluating applications, discussing with the group and ranking and all of that. I think, you know, you have to be a participant. So what I was thinking was two participant board members, and then which I was thinking Anna and Robert, and I think and then Jonathan could be co-chair, because the board has to appoint a co-chair of the committee. That means you're not voting, you're not doing that kind of work. You're running the meeting as you run this meeting. Mm-hmm. It doesn't give you you have more of a role in our meetings, obviously.
You do vote,
but this is a different, you know, I mean, you can say, mm-hmm. okay, just runs the meeting. Mm-hmm. So I was going to suggest that or make a motion for that to accommodate the interest.
Okay. And Trustee Haslund, Trustee Everett, what are your thoughts on moving forward?
I'm not sure this is a matter of accommodating. I think we have an obligation to appoint two. Therefore, I would nominate Anna and Robert.
Okay. Is there we're going to take a vote on this. So is that a motion to nominate Anna and Robert?
That's what I said.
Okay. Yes. Is there a second?
No, one second.
Okay, we will do this by a roll call vote. And Romina Kelly, take it away.
Student Trustee Raja Osera?
Yes.
Trustee Gallardo?
Yes.
Trustee Croninger?
Yes.
Trustee Parker?
Aye.
Trustee Haslund?
Aye.
Trustee Everett?
I can vote for myself?
Yes, you can.
Aye.
Trustee Miller?
Yes.
All right. That passes unanimously with Trustee Abood absent. And I'll note that, that might have been a different discussion if Trustee Abood had been here. I agree with Peter that it's probably better that it just be two members. And this is a semi-flexible process, but the entire board is going to be so involved with this once we get past the screening committee that I am not concerned at all about who's involved.
We do need to pick a chair as well. That's on our timeline.
Is that on for today?
It's on our timeline for today.
Now, I guess that
co-chair.
Yeah. I guess that I would ask Trustee Haslund to amend your motion and maybe like do a, it's not on here separately. So it needs to be part of the original motion that you nominate two members to the screening committee, and one of them specifically is the co-chair. If you're willing to.
And one of them as co-chair?
One of them has to be co-chair of the screening committee.
The board policy says
two
members appointed, and one of them shall be, what doesn't say one of them, it just says the a board member will be a co-chair.
Well, do either of you have a preference?
I'm willing, but
all right, she's willing.
Okay. Congratulations. I would just urge careful thought. I mean, the role of chair or co-chair is likely to be a time-consuming activity. And though, you know, I guess I could say one further word that I've served as president of this board on three occasions, and I have found that I am much more at liberty to participate fully if I'm not the chair. So that's just input for both of you.
One question I have is that, again, in some ways I'm surprised that it's a policy that a board member is a co-chair, because this is really so much of a community process that I would have thought that we would not have served as a co-chair. But the in the superintendent searches that you've done before, I assume there was a board co-chair.
No, because we didn't have any board members. But that's why we wrote it into the new policy that we would have a board
member as a co-chair. Right. Well, again, I would just say that this very much needs to be shared, and that it would be as much the other co-chairs' involvement and weight in running. And I think that selection of that co-chair is going to be critical during your first meeting, because I really think that it's so important to the community perception reality that the screening committee process is more their process than a board process. So I'll just note that. And I just want to double check. I feel like you've been chair of have you been chair of the women's commission? Yeah, I mean, you have chair experience, so this is not like it's something new to you.
Exactly. Right?
Okay. With that, I will request, I'm just wondering, I'm a little bit nervous about making two separate motions for one action item when it's not called out separately. So if we can just redo this vote, that would be better. So Peter, do you want to adjust your
motion? If you wish, I'll amend my motion to include Anna as the co-chair.
And then the second was you, Anna, right? Were you the second on that?
I don't think I seconded that. I just said I was
willing. I think I did the second.
Marcia seconded.
Are you willing to accept the amendment?
Yeah, I'll accept.
Okay. All right. With that, we're going to scratch the first vote and redo the roll call.
So student trustee Raja O'Sara?
Yes.
Trustee Gallardo?
Yes.
Trustee Croninger?
Yes.
Trustee Parker?
Aye.
Trustee Haslund?
Aye.
Trustee Everett?
Aye.
And Trustee Miller?
Aye.
Great. And that brings us to 17.5, the 22-23 board goals. This is something that we've reviewed. We now, I hope, have the correct draft revised board goals on here. And it is ready for action. Did somebody want to go ahead and get a motion on the floor? It's moved by Trustee Haslund to approve.
Second.
And seconded by Trustee Everett. Any questions or comments on the revisions? Trustee Croninger.
I would like to suggest a clarification, which is to 1.3, which says ensure the fiscal sustainability of the college through strategic use of one-time reserve funds. And I would add above policy minimums, because I'm not envisioning we are doing that, spending down our policy reserves.
Okay, I see what you're saying.
Is that accepted?
Yeah. All right, with that, we have a motion that includes that clarification on item 1.3, and this will be a roll call vote.
Student trustee Raja O'Sara?
Yes.
Trustee Miller?
Yes.
Trustee Hatland?
Aye.
Trustee Gallardo?
Yes.
Trustee Parker?
Aye.
Trustee Croninger?
Yes.
Trustee Everett?
Aye.
Great. That passes unanimously with Trustee Abood absent. We're at 17.6, the 2023 master planning calendar. I really love this document. I love being able to look ahead at all this. All the work that you all are going to be doing next year. Good luck with that.
I think that calls for a motion of censure.
This is just on for a first reading, so we're not taking action on this tonight. Any feedback on the draft that you want to give? Go ahead, Trustee Croninger.
Okay. Suggestion that we put we're going to be deciding on the dates of our meetings.
And yeah, that's the next item.
I know. Yeah. But once we've done that, this is first reading, then I suggest we go back and put the date in of the meeting rather than just the month. And when you do that in terms of the proposal, you'll see that we've got a couple of the columns reversed. So our June board retreat, for example, is June 1st. And above it is June 15th, a board meeting. So you'd want to flip those.
I see what you're saying.
Same thing with the September study session, September 15th board meeting.
Gotcha.
Flip those. I think it would be helpful to get the FTES reports after we submit them. We had the recal tonight, but we didn't typically get the ones through the session. So in other words, February and July, I believe, or whatever follows when we're actually submitting it. So we
So that would be, we submit in January, we submit in April, and we submit July, and then recalc is October.
Right. Just so we are more in touch with where we are, particularly since we're rather close to the 10,000 number. We have, I think, an expectation that we're going to get a report on the seismic evaluation of our facilities and the environmental history of the facilities. And I understand that was aiming for March. So I was looking at the study session. Maybe we could put it under other as something that we'll be seeing by then. But I don't know the exact date. Study session seemed like a good place. I'm looking at April 20th or April. That has superintendent president's goals. I don't think it belongs there. I think it was out of sync because Dr. Goswami came in January. So we're back in sync with July 1. And that would move it to September 15th, maybe, or maybe the following meeting. But that would be the cycle.
Okay.
So we can do board goals, superintendent president goals after that. Let's see. For the 5-year capital outlay plan, we have it down for the June 15th board meeting. That's under action. I would prefer we also have one for the previous meeting where we get to see the draft and talk about it. So that would be the May 18th meeting under reports or whatever you want to, first reading, whatever you want to talk, characterize that. But I'd like us to have it to talk about first.
So do you want to do quarterly / 5-year budget? Because the quarterly is listed there in May.
So say that again.
Did you want to just add, so it says under the month of May, academic calendar, quarterly budget adjustments. Do you want to do quarterly / 5-year budget, put them together, or?
They're pretty different. Okay.
I would just put the under reports. We'd do a first read with the 5-year capital outlay in May.
Yeah.
Which we did last year.
Yeah, we did. I'm just, since we're trying to capture the things that we are doing as well. And November 16, which would be this meeting, we had our master planning calendar discussion. So seems like something we might want to put on there, and the FTES recal. And then my last suggestion is that we move, well, this comes out of the next item, but that we move the December 21 date for the last meeting to the December 14th.
Yeah, we can talk about that on the next item.
Yeah.
All right, and Trustee Gallardo?
Yes, thank you, Kate. Career technical education, that is specifically construction tech and nursing. Those are things that are pretty critical in the community. I know that we've been waiting for some things, but this needs to, it should really be a standing report. We used to have them when Lori was here. I was looking at a couple of them, and a lot of them have been captured here, but career technical education, since Melissa's been gone, we haven't really seen.
Is that captured under strong workforce update?
Mm-hmm. No, strong workforce is yes and no, but we're, not with the reporting that we need to look at nursing and construction tech. Our construction companies are struggling, and they're really looking at community colleges. And in Santa Barbara, we are the only community college. And then nursing, of course, Westmont has started their program to fill that need, but Santa Barbara City College is going to be the most accessible to help support cottage in that area. So I think we do need one for CTE, specifically with those two in mind. Those are our big ones in the community.
Any other comments on the draft calendar?
Yes.
Just one. It's my recollection, correct me if I'm wrong, that this is a fairly dynamic document, sure, that it's subject to change, and that this, even though we approve it, can be and should be considered a first draft, maybe a second draft, but be prepared for number 6, 7, and 8 as it goes along.
Yeah, they'll approve it at the December org meeting, and then it will definitely change.
It's more of a don't forget.
Yeah, don't forget.
Yeah, that's what it's for.
All right, so speaking of board meetings, 17.7, this is the 2023 draft of the board meeting schedule. And Trustee Croninger had noted December 21st is legal, but pretty late for a annual org meeting, and thinking of bumping that forward to the 14th.
Yeah, we'll move it.
Right. So any other comments on that?
Yes.
Yes.
The September 1 and September 15 dates are both Fridays. I don't think that was intentional. My guess is it was meant to be August 31 and September 14.
There you go.
Mm.
All right. Okay. They'll get that.
Unless you want to retreat on Friday, which would be the September 1, but the 15th should definitely be the 14th.
Well, it's a study
session. 15th should be the 14th, you guys need to figure out the study session, because you'll probably want to do that in September, not August, but it's up to you. So think about that.
We'll correct September.
All right. And Veronica.
Yeah, can we move the December 21st date because it's so close to Christmas Eve with
we're
going to move it to December 14th.
Okay, sorry, I didn't catch that.
Yeah. All right. Report from board members. Yes.
I really appreciate how we are making mental health a priority this year. So Duel has been doing lots of workshops that students appreciate so much. And I was thinking, how could we support our students 24/7 and at no cost? And I went to ACCT with Dr. Murillo and Trustee Everett, and one of ACCT student success partner is Timely Care, and that's an app that I am currently familiarizing myself with it so that I could bring it to our Center of Equity and Justice. And it would be great to have Timely Care as a partner so students could be provided counseling at any time and at no cost. And I'm also working on gathering data to work on a grant to help transfer students transferring. So application fees are unfortunately very expensive, and lots of students don't meet the criteria to be eligible for a fee waiver while applying to four-year institutions. So with my co-chair, Robert, who is the VP of Finance in DSG, and other ASG members such as the President Diallo and the VP of External Affairs, Divya Ramesh, we have an internal committee within DSG. And what we are doing at the moment is writing a proposal to Jeff Green, so to the foundation, to potentially have them help us financing those grants and consequently increase transfer rates and support our students and encourage them to strive academically. So, yeah.
Thank you. That sounds fascinating. And can I just ask you to repeat, what was the name of that that no-cost support tool for students?
That's Timely Care.
How do you spell that?
Timely. So T-I-M-E-L-Y.
And Timely Care. Okay, gotcha. So I will definitely look that up.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Wow. Timely Care. Seeing it right here. Trustee Haslin and then Trustee Everett.
Yes, in my role as your representative to the County Committee on School District Organization, I have one task during the year, which is to cast a ballot for two representatives on this committee. This year, the 1st and 5th District were up. And so I dutifully cast my ballot for the two people who were nominated, Terry Hickey Banks for the 1st Supervisorial District and Juanita Gutierrez Nichols for the 5th District. So I did that. It was a very formal and terribly untime consuming activity, but I'm glad to have done it. Secondly, I have had conversation with members of the Santa Barbara Unified School District about one of my concerns having to do with communication between faculty from City College, faculty from our secondary schools. And there is genuine interest on that score. I had conversation with Dr. Murillo, who offered, I thought, a really insightful point. That is, it's more likely to work if this is informal as opposed to formal, bottom up rather than top down. So it's something I'll pursue with individual faculty members because I think one of the expressions of that concern has been that faculty on our side has often complained about the students coming from secondary schools and not being prepared. And I can't help but feel that a direct communication between the two would lean in the direction of supporting our long-held goal of a sort of seamless educational system. I just think that if the parties to the instructional process could somehow find a way of talking with each other about how they approach the task of teaching and what their mutual expectations are, I think we'd get a lot further ahead.
Great. And Trustee Everett, and then Trustee Croninger and Trustee Gallardo, I see you online.
I'd just like to follow up a little bit more on the Association of Community College Trustees conference that we went to in New York. And just to say a couple of things, it was my first time attending and it was amazing. It was wonderful. It was packed. But the sessions were just so informative. I made sure to go to the one on selecting your next CEO, you know, and it was in one of the biggest rooms in the conference. It was full. So our effort to move forward was really good because everybody's looking for, well, not everybody, but a lot of people are looking for their next community college CEO. So that one was real informative. I took copious notes and I'm really excited to be able to kind of think about them as we're moving through the process. But it was also great to have Angelina there, you know, as a student trustee, and I was impressed with how well she navigated the space and, you know, just kind of was able to fit right in. But I particularly want to acknowledge that even though Dr. Murillo was dealing with like a phone call every minute, dealing with stuff, you know, she was very present. But again, we just are so lucky to have her because, like I said, the testimonials, the unsolicited testimonials keep coming in. But it was just a delight to be there with her. And I want to thank her for making that first trip for me and student trustee available. And it was a really useful. And I went to just about every session, one on having DEI as a part of your institutional DNA. I mean, they had some really good sessions. And so it was a wonderful experience. So thank you for that. And it was a pleasure. And it was in New York City. It was crazy. It was great.
Awesome. Trustee Croninger.
I was just going to ask Peter if he would be willing to expand his sites to include conversations among faculty at UCSB as well with our faculty, because there are transitions there and ideas about students transferring that I think could be useful as well.
Good point, Trustee Gallardo.
To keep you busy.
Sure. I mean, as of December 15th, I'm relegated to a position on the other side of that microphone giving public comment. But if it's a will of the body, I'll be glad to continue at least at that informal level and include UCSB in my conversations, because I think you're right.
Veronica?
Yeah, I attended the military ball on Saturday evening, and we already do a lot for our veterans here at the college and anything more we could do. And so just a heartfelt thanks for our veterans, their families, and as well as our active members of the military. Many were present there, and our freedom, which we don't take lightly, is in part due to their sacrifice. So it was a well-attended event, such a beautiful ceremony, fundraiser. And I just want to say thank you. And thank you to Santa Barbara City College for all that the program does and to continue expanding and doing the great work. They deserve it all.
Thank you. I just have one thing to share, something to think about at your org meeting. I don't know who your K-12 rep will be. Something that I kind of continued informally from my previous board is that I don't think anybody on this board is aware of is the Santa Barbara County School Boards Association. Dean Evans and I used to hang out at that quite a bit. And Greg Pensa is always there from Allen Hancock. And I think that there is benefit to hearing what's going on in the K-12 world across the county. So it's essentially quite a few of the county school districts will send a board member there. And so it is heavily K-12, but they want to hear what's going on at the community colleges, and they do have important things to share too. And it's by Zoom on Thursday mornings at 8:30. So it is just something, I'll send an email about it as well, but it might be something that you want to include in the duties of your K-12 rep. I think that is it for me for board reports. And that brings us, if I can get the right agenda back open again, to items for future board consideration. Is there anything that anybody wants to add to the list at this time? If not, we will. We have no need to reconvene to close session. Our next meetings are the two special meetings after Thanksgiving. So I hope you all have a wonderful Thanksgiving break. And if there are no objections from the board, we will go ahead and adjourn this meeting of Thursday, November 10th. See you after the break.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.